Good morning. I'll call to order the regular meeting of the Zoning and Planning Committee. I'm Lisa Bender. I chair the committee. Today is May 19th, 2016, and we have a quorum with Council Members Reich, Goodman, and Council President Johnson. Council Member Andrew Johnson is absent, and Council Member Abdi Warsami is on city business today. We have six items on our agenda. The first two will hold public hearings. So we'll start with the consent agenda. Item number three has been withdrawn by the applicant. That was a rezoning application. Item number four is approving a rezoning at 1911 Nicollet Avenue from C1 to C2, retaining the existing pedestrian overlay district. Item number five is a report back that was scheduled on our civic engagement plan for our comprehensive plan update. I'm going to move to postpone that one cycle to allow staff more time to develop some more detail beyond what they have been talking with council members about. And item number six is an environmental assessment worksheet that's for 600 Washington Avenue Southeast. So I will move items four and six for approval. Madam Clerk, do we need to take action on the withdrawn item? Move to accept the withdrawal. Okay. I'm going to just move this all as one motion, but let me know if that's not okay. So I will move to withdraw, to approve the withdrawal of item, accept the withdrawal of item number three, approve item number four, postpone item five one cycle, and approve item number six. Is there any discussion on those four items? Seeing none, all in approval, please say aye. 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 Any opposed? And those carry. That brings us back to item number one, our first public hearing item. And we'll start with a presentation from staff. This is an appeal of a certificate of appropriateness and historic variance application at 1900 Colfax Avenue South.
Good morning, council members. You are here this morning to consider an appeal submitted by the St. Paul Development Corporation regarding the April 19th, 2016 decision of the Heritage Preservation Commission to deny a certificate of appropriateness application to construct a new four-story, five-unit residential building on the southern half of the property next to the F.E. Day House, which is an individual landmark, and a historic variance to maintain the existing setback from the interior property line of the F.E. Day House located at 1900 Colfax Avenue South. These are photos of the F.E. Day House, which is the individual landmark. And this is at 1900 Colfax. And I wanted to show you the survey of the property as this will come into the conversation or my presentation this morning. This is the 1900 Colfax Avenue South property. There is a second platted lot, historically had an address of 1906 Colfax Avenue South. The HPC denied the applications for three reasons. First, the proposed development would be incompatible with the preservation of the property and other properties in the area. The proposed development would impact the setting of the individual landmark, and the variance isn't necessary to alleviate a practical difficulty due to special circumstances or conditions unique to the property. The appellant, St. Paul Development Corporation, is appealing the decision for three reasons. First, the adjacent lot, the vacant lot, has no historical significance. Second, the construction of the improvement does not physically alter the landmark. And lastly, the side yard setback for the landmark's interior property line is historically consistent. This is the site plan for the proposed development. This is the 1906, or excuse me, this is the F.E. Day House at 1900 Colfax. There is an existing garage on the property. This is where the proposed development at 1906 would be built. That is that southern half of the lot that is vacant. However, there is a four-car garage on the property. So I guess it's not vacant, but it is without a primary structure. Constructed in 1908, the F.E. Day House is a well-conserved example the Colonial Revival style, as demonstrated by the symmetrical composition, central entrance with flanking sidelights, rectangular double-hung sash windows, and brick cladding. The house was designed by prolific Minneapolis architect Ernest C. Haley, who designed nearly 60 extant buildings in Minneapolis, many of which are located in the Groveland Addition, part of the Lowry Hill neighborhood. The F.E. Day House was designated in 2009. Again, the property consists of two platted lots that were originally addressed as 1900 and 1906 Colfax. The property at 1906 Colfax once had a house on it. The house was built in 1895 and was demolished in 1916. At some point in the past, the two properties were combined under one tax identification number, but were never platted as one property. The landmark building is located on the 1900 Colfax lot. As part of the development, the applicant will reestablish the tax identification number for both platted lots, therefore establishing the interior property line again. The applicant is proposing to construct this four-story, five-unit building. This is the F.E. Day House, and this is the adjacent apartment building to the south. So this is the proposed new development. And then these are the other sides of the proposed new development. Again, this would be applied on the southern half of the landmark property, which has that four-car garage on it. The new building is of a simple modern style. The building will be rectangular in form with a primarily flat roof. Here are some renderings. The entrance and staircase element will have a low hip roof. There will be balconies on the front of the building. The exterior materials of the building include horizontal lap siding and metal shingles attached in a diamond pattern. And that new construction would be built 11 feet from the F.E. Day House. It's important to note that the applicant is not proposing to make any exterior modifications to the landmark building. At the HPC meeting, the CPED staff recommendation was to approve both of the applications. And the reasons for that were that the proposed new construction will not physically alter the landmark and therefore will continue to support the criteria of significance and period of significance for which it was designated. The F.E. Day House is significant for its architecture, the architect who built it, and its association with Progressive Era social history. Although when the property was designated, the southern lot was empty other than the garage, this was not noted as an integral part to the significance of the landmark. And the new building is of a simple modern style and would be compatible with the design of the landmark building. I'm going to conclude here and stand for any questions.
Mr. Ward, can you just remind me how the F.E. Day House is being used now? I'm just curious.
There are seven dwelling units in the F.E. Day House today.
Are there any other questions for staff? Okay, then we will open the public hearing for this item. We should start with the applicant, so if anyone would like to come up from the applicant team. And then we do have a few people signed in to speak as well, and everyone will get a chance to speak.
Good morning, Chair Bender and members of the committee. My name is Sylvia Frank. I'm representing the owner of the property. I'm with Carlson and Frank Architects, and we've been working with the owner to design the proposed project. I'd like to support this project. This project has been designed to fit the existing zoning requirements and doesn't require any variances. The zoning on this property has been set by the city, and the zoning reflects the city's feelings of how this property should be developed and what's compatible with its surrounding neighborhood. I would argue that the project as proposed is compatible with the surrounding neighborhood. in looking at the setbacks on the surrounding properties, going 300 feet in either direction along Colfax Avenue, they range from 0 feet to about 27 feet. And this property has a setback of 15 feet 6 inches to the balconies and 19 feet to the structure of the building. So it's well within the range of what setbacks are. As far as the height goes on the building, it reflects what you see in the neighborhood. The structures run from 2 stories up to 4 stories. And within a block of this structure, our high-rise is a high-rise building. So I'd argue that both with setbacks and with height of the building, it's compatible with the surrounding neighborhood. As Ms. Dvorak mentioned, there is a history on this lot, and these two properties were originally platted as 2 separate 50-foot wide lots. And this reflects what you see in the surrounding neighborhood. It's typically a pattern of 50-foot wide lots with a house on each lot. That's historically the way this area was developed. Colfax Avenue doesn't have an alley. The blocks on either side of Colfax don't have an alley. So typically these houses were developed so that they'd be set back, say, 4 feet from the side property line, and they'd have a wider setback on the opposite side to allow room for a driveway. So this really fit the development of the day house here, fit within an existing pattern, established pattern of one house per lot. When the designation study was done for this property, we think that there was an oversight or an error made in designating the lot to the south. As was mentioned, this house on the lot to the south of the day house site was built in 1896, and it existed there until after the day house was built. It was demolished in 1916. The Days never owned this property. These two lots have existed as separate lots since they were platted. At some point in time, they came under one tax ID number. But that doesn't mean that they suddenly became separate. They became joined. So in looking back at how this lot might have been designated as part of the historic property, I have asked what the Minneapolis guidelines are for designating historic sites, individual sites. And I was told that Minneapolis doesn't have its own set of guidelines. They rely on the Department of Interior guidelines when they designate historic sites. And those guidelines very carefully outline the boundaries of what a site should be. And I'm not going to quote you everything they say under the boundaries section, but just to pull out a couple portions that are relevant to this argument. They say the selected boundaries should be justified as appropriate to the historic property. And they say, thus, boundaries should correspond as closely as possible to the actual extent and configuration of the property and should be carefully selected to encompass but not exceed the extent of the significant resources. So the in designating the Effie Day House, that designation didn't agree with these guidelines. And unfortunately, there's no process to correct what may have been an error or oversight. And the HPC does not seem interested in getting involved in making this kind of correction and has simply decided that while the southern lot has been designated with a day house, therefore it's historic and we have to look at it using the historic guidelines. So I don't think that the city should be in the business of reinventing history, which is what this seems to be doing. There's also the issue here of the city is saying that the Effie Day House now requires a variance for a 4-foot side yard setback to the south. When the Day House was built, it conformed to the zoning and building codes at the time. And typically, the city doesn't go backward and say, oh, the codes have changed. Now we're going to go into this building situation and make them correct this error. It's generally grandfathered in. So since the lots have been separate lots, since they were plotted, and since the house conformed to the zoning requirements at the time, it seems questionable to me that the city should require a variance for this side yard setback. And by doing this, it seems as if the city could potentially limit the owner in what he can do to his property. It could make the property useless to him because he might not be allowed to build anything on the site. And in fact, one member of the HPC did say, I don't think it's appropriate for anything to be built on this site. I think that the HPC seems to be overstepping its bounds in not approving this project. And as you know, the staff recommendation was for approval of this project. And then there's one more item that I'd like to mention. There's a driveway easement between the existing day house and the garage that belongs to the day house. That has existed for decades and gives access to the garages that are on the back of the lot to the south. This is very useful in developing the site to the south because it gives parking. Well, the city has determined that parking isn't required at this site. Because it's so close to public transport. But the neighborhood would like to see parking, off-street parking for this project. And so that driveway easement does allow that off-street parking and maintains as much green space on the site as possible. So the owner is trying to be conscientious in developing his project in an efficient way. And just in conclusion, I'd like to say you really should support the owner's proposal.
Councilmember Goodman has a question.
Ms. Frank, are you the applicant's lawyer?
No,
so
I'm
his architect.
So
why didn't you speak to any of the architectural issues and you're speaking to the designation issues? I see Mr. Meyer here. I'm wondering if you're offering a legal opinion and I should be asking you my question with regard to the legal opinion. But it sounds like you're not a lawyer.
No, I'd be happy to address architectural questions you have about the project.
It was your testimony. If you're the architect, I would assume your testimony would have been about the historic character of the house next door, how the materials do or do not comport with the Secretary of Interior standards, how the height does or does not influence the houses on either side. You didn't speak to any of that. You gave us your opinion with regard to the designation. Were you around for the designation in 2010? Did you work for the St. Paul Development Corporation in 2010? Were you familiar with the designation or part of it?
Yes or no? Not an attorney. I'm an architect. Mm-hmm. I have to tell you, I'm the former chair of the St. Paul HPC. I'm aware of what the HPC guidelines are and what the Department of Interior standards are. And they ask that the materials used on construction that's related or close to a historic building, they don't have to exactly match what's there. If you're connecting to an historic building, they want to maintain the character of the existing building and have a definition between the two, the new and the old defined. So we aren't touching that building. The materials that are proposed for this project are lap siding, horizontal lap siding, that's very much like other houses in the neighborhood, and shingles up above. These are materials that you'd find on homes around the neighborhood, in the surrounding neighborhood.
Madam Chair, Ms. Frank, how does your proposed design fit with the scale and proportion of and massing of the historic property next door? And how does it comport with the materials on both sides of this lot? The materials, I believe, are brick.
Yes, they are brick. But one house beyond the apartment building to the south, a couple of houses there have horizontal lap siding. And the house immediately across Lincoln Avenue from the Day House has horizontal lap siding. And it's from about the same era as the Day House. So really, horizontal lap siding is not incompatible with what you see immediately across the street and within 100 feet or less of this site.
But it's not next door, and it's not, you, Mr. McCarty, they're filming this for the whole public to see, so you don't have to film it on your phone, because you'll be able to get access to the tape to this later, just so you know. The buildings on both sides are brick. It says in the Secretary of Interior standards that the new work shouldn't look like it's old, but should have features, size, scale, and proportion and massing to protect the integrity of the property and its environment. So how does this design, its height and scale, match with the historic context, which I would say is of the house next door?
Well, if you pull up the elevations of the building side by side, you can see how it relates to the building, the Day House next door.
It doesn't relate. That's why I'm asking you, how does it relate? Tell me how. I must be the only one who thinks that something taller and kind of odd, partial modern fits in the context with the houses on either side, or the apartment building and the house on the other side.
I think you need to look at the immediate neighborhood, not just the buildings to either side. And if you go kitty corner across the street to the northeast, there are stucco buildings that are four stories high, some townhouse projects. There's a mix of materials in this neighborhood. So
your testimony,
I guess,
is
my
it doesn't
argument
matter.
Is this, that if this lot has been improperly designated as a historic property, then it shouldn't fall under the HPC guidelines.
Okay, Mr. Nelson, Madam Chair, we can review this. I don't have any more questions for Ms. Frank.
Maybe we.
I want Mr. Nelson to speak to whether or not this house was improperly designated, because I can go through the history of this. And in fact, Mr. McCarty and his lawyer sued the city over this designation and lost. And in fact, in the context of this designation study, the legally described lots were lots 1 and 2, which is the lot next door. And that was not appealed at that time. So we're not going to be relitigating whether or not the house was designated. It was. Mr. Nelson, can you speak to this?
Sure, Madam Chair, Councilmember Goodman. I think the real issue here is that the opportunity to challenge the designation in any fashion has passed. You're correct. It was the subject of a lawsuit in 2010 that alleged various notice defects with regard to the denial of a demolition permit, as well as the designation. And the city was awarded summary judgment, and that was not appealed. In addition, designation decisions are considered quasi-judicial decisions by the courts. And so in order to challenge a designation, it must be done by writ of cert to the Court of Appeals within 60 days of that decision. And that was not done here. So whether the applicant likes it or not, the designated property is 1900 Colfax, which is a designated double lot. And so that's where we sit today. Just noting also that in looking back at the record, that the city council's resolution when it was designated actually, I think, made it explicitly clear. On April 30th, 2010, the city council resolution stated, quote, that the F.E. Day House encompassing the entire property at 1900 Colfax Avenue South, and then it references including the day house and the detached garage. So what you have before you is a designated double lot, and that and so arguments pertaining to whether the designation was proper, improper, et cetera, are really not relevant to the issue that is now before you.
Okay. Thank you for your testimony. I think we'll move along with the public hearing. And we do have Mr. Meyer and Mr. McCarty both signed in to speak. So whoever would like to speak next, please come up. I would like to ask that folks now keep their testimony to about 2 minutes, just given the length of the original testimony there.
I'm not even sure I'm going to take 2 minutes. Thank you. As mentioned, my name is Neil Meyer. I'm from Meyer & Neuse, and I represent the applicant. The applicant has owned this property since 2000, and as counsel said, there was an application in about 2009 to redevelop the property. This was denied, and the designation was granted. Now the applicant has come back to seek to designate the property again. So this is an ongoing thing that's been going. He's been thinking about this for 16 years and actively trying to do this for the last six or seven. When this designation was done, the focus of the designation was on the Colonial Revival style of the home and of the master architect. So we're not proposing to touch that house at all. This is a separate development from the house, and it is independent from it, and it will not impact the historic nature of the house. The lot was included in the designation in 2009. I'm not going to argue that. The lot was included, but the lot was not given any historic significance in the designation study. There's a brief mention of it. The property consists of two lots stretching 100 feet in width and 135 feet in depth. That's from the 2009 study. And this 2016 staff report says, although when the property was designated, the southern lot, lot two, was empty other than the garage, this was not noted as integral to the significance of the landmark. So although legally you lump them two together, technically there's no historic significance to this lot. It's bare land. And when the F.E. Day House was constructed by Ernest Haley, another home existed on that house. And so what we're proposing to do, what the applicant is proposing to do, is nothing more than what has already been done to that property and put a new construction on the property. This new construction is not going to physically alter the day house. I believe the secretary's criteria about massing and all the other things relate to improvements that are going to be attached to or part of the structure. This is a separate structure. It has nothing to do with it. There's going to be a 15-foot separation between the two. In the HPC, they talked about setting and feeling. And setting is the surrounding, the setting is the physical environment of the property. And as noted in the designation study in 2009, the setting of the surroundings of the property is partially intact. The property is adjacent to an area of transition from higher density apartment buildings to detached single family dwellings. The properties to the south of these buildings are mid-rise family structures dating to the mid-20th century. And feeling is a property's expression of the aesthetic or historic sense of a particular period. And the noted in the 2009 study, the transitioning neighborhood that surrounds the property diminishes the feeling of cohesiveness. This is This is the drawing that Ms. Dvorak showed, and I borrowed it from her. I walk this neighborhood with my puppy, and I pick up after him, too. These apartment buildings, this mid-century, 1950s, I would call it, apartment building is adjacent to the F.E. Day House, separated by the bare land. If you walk down the street, there's Birch. We used to be Birch Pharmacy, now the Birch Restaurant. There's Brad Street Restaurant. Across the street is Sebastian Joe's. This is an area that's in transition to the Lowry Hill neighborhood. It's not really part of it. And all we're seeking to do is build up a 5-unit apartment building, fitting in with the city's intent to have density in the neighborhoods, right next to mass transit. It's right by Hennepin Avenue. This side yard setback, as noted, the property is 4 feet from its sideline. The new property is going to be 11 feet. There'll be a 15-foot separation. There's going to be no confusion between the two properties. This is a reasonable thing to do for this land. To deny this, we think, would be unfair and harmful to the owner's intent to use this property. He has maintained the day house consistent with the historic designation. We ask your permission to allow him to construct this apartment building, welcoming new residents to the neighborhood. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. McCarty, would you like to speak? Is there anyone else who would like to speak on this item?
Thank you. I just would like to ask for your support of this project that we've worked very diligently and hard on, and we think that it'll be a great asset for the city of Minneapolis. Thank you.
Thank you. So anyone else who would like to speak, please come up. If you could then, if you haven't yet, after you're done speaking, please check in with the clerk and we'll get your name and address for the record. And I'd like you to ask you to keep your testimony to 2 to 3 minutes or so. Want to give you ample time, but also keep the public hearing moving along.
I will try to keep my time brief. My name is Robert Hink. I live at 1820 Colfax, the property directly to the north of the F.E. Day House across Lincoln. I'm speaking here today as one who I believe is uniquely qualified as a lifelong resident. I have lived in this property my entire life for nearly 60 years. I am a registered architect here in Minneapolis, in Minnesota. And I don't want to speak to the point of belaboring all the issues that have been pointed out, other than to say the HPC did a diligent job in considering all the criteria that they had to continually refer to this parcel of land that the F.E. Day House sits on, which is merely described legally as lots 1 and 2 of block 33. To say it is two separate lots, two parcels, is disingenuous, because if you go to any of the adjacent properties nearby there, it is not uncommon to have more than one lot. It is unique to have only one lot. The way the lots were platted originally was merely a device for dividing up the land before anything was built. And this land that they keep referring to as vacant and bare is not. The F.E. Day House has enjoyed the use of the additional square footage, not only to have a garage and off-street parking, but it also allows for the number of units that are currently in the building. Trying to divide the parcel into two lots as they propose would make the F.E. Day House non-compliant. That would be an issue that would be coming back before the Zoning and Planning Commission. We weren't able to truly address that through the HPC. What they did address, though, is the context of the neighborhood and of, you know, the character of the structure itself. In putting something directly to the south of it there, which would be essentially, quite literally, a 28-foot by 72 foot by 50 foot high wall to the south, is just going to be blocking that off and, you know, bookending the neighborhood with something that is so dissimilar, you know, in indifference to the historic character of the neighborhood, Lowry Hill, which this is part of, not on the front of some other mysterious neighborhood. Yes, some transition has taken place. I have seen many years of it. It is not to say that something could not be done with this, but to simply ignore that the structures surrounding it are out of brick, you know, proposing something with the lower portion in brick or stone certainly would have been at least a nod to that historic character. Also something a little bit smaller in scale rather than, you know, roughly 20 feet higher than everything else immediately adjacent does change the feel of the neighborhood. And again, this is something that I personally and professionally have felt and can testify to, that the HPC did it right in considering this. There is no need for a variance if the owner decides to do nothing right now. He is imposing this hardship on himself by this proposal. I mean, there is no need for a variance currently. And posing that this drive that cuts through it, they are also changing the drive to the point that it benefits only one portion of the site to the detriment of the Effie Day house, and also cutting into the street with an additional curb cut that quite oddly would put on that side of the street three large driveways directly adjacent. So, and it impacts an area where parking is at a premium. People do drive cars. People need to store them somewhere. Being that, yes, zoning requirements have changed to the point where it is no longer necessary to provide them. And as historically they pointed out, there had been a house there on this lot too. There had been no garage.
Thank you.
With that, if there's any questions, I would certainly welcome to respond. Okay, thank you for your time.
Thank you so much. Next speaker, come on up.
Hello, my name is Jane Dietrich, and I live at 1821 DuPont Avenue South. I'm just around the corner from this from the Day House. And our house is built in 1899, and the beautiful house at 1900 Colfax, since if we wouldn't be talking about it if the owner would have been allowed to tear it down and build an apartment house there in 1910 or before that. So we're happy to have that house. We drive down Colfax and you see this beautiful house, and it's reminiscent of all the other beautiful houses in the neighborhood. And one of the nice things that's happened since we bought our house in 1992 is that people have taken more pride in their houses, I think, at least in that part of Lowry Hill, and they've improved their houses and their taxes have gone up, so that's good. And for the city or for the county. And anyway, we do take pride, and I think that this development would be a blight on the neighborhood. It doesn't fit in. The existing house is beautiful and has a lot of tenants already. And one of the things that is concern to me is that the block is extremely congested on Colfax. There's nowhere to park in Colfax. And parking is restricted. Excuse me. Trucks and vans often block the street while unloading goods for the restaurants. And street parking is not only limited on Colfax, but also on Lincoln and on DuPont. It is often difficult for visitors to my home to find a place to park. The driveway to 1900 Colfax exits on Lincoln across from my backyard and will probably be used as an entrance exit from the new building, which means that Lincoln will be even busier than it is now. And visitors to that new building will be looking for a place to park on the street. For example, yesterday I went out and counted the cars that were parked on Lincoln between DuPont and Colfax, and there are 11 cars parked there at 4 p.m. in the afternoon. To me, this is an outrageous proposal by owners who care nothing about our neighborhood and only care about the amount of money they can squeeze from their house at 1900 Colfax. Why should we allow a developer from another city to diminish our neighborhood? Thank you.
Thank you. Would anyone else like to speak?
Pardon me?
Would anyone else like to speak? No problem.
Can I use the visual aid?
Yep. You can just put the items on the screen there and then
just put it
appear.
On there?
Yep.
Okay.
And then just a reminder for folks who are speaking to please check in with the clerk to so we get your information.
I have a couple to show you. Pictures are usually helpful. My name is Tony DeRamo. I am a resident of 1920 Colfax Avenue South. I'm just down the street. I'm a 26-year resident of Lowry Hill, a property owner, and a Lowry Hill Neighborhood Association board member. I'm not speaking for the board today, but I am a member. I ask the committee to deny the appeal to build the four-story apartment building in the side yard of 1900 Colfax. The 1900 block of Colfax Avenue South serves as a gateway and a buffer to historic Lowry Hill. Over the years, the block has been abused by teardowns and constructions of structures inappropriate and incongruous in both look and feel for this treasured old city neighborhood. I ask the committee deny the appeal. The HPC decision noted the specific pointed language in the historic designation that covered the house and the full lot. The designation says, this was from the conversations at the HPC meeting. The designation says the entire property, every map shows both lots. This would alter the feeling of the house, the present day ability to convey the past. The lot is important to that. Whether or not we should question any building on the lot is appropriate. The commission had asked the applicant for some reconsiderations, which he ignored. The setbacks, I'm not certain that they are compliant. When you look at the protrusion of the balconies, they are inside the regular variances that they were talking about. The building to the south is closer to the sidewalk, but to me, a mistake from the past should not beget a mistake for the future. The easement with the driveway, this shared drive which crosses through the historic property, dividing the house from a garage behind it, devalues the historic property. It is unfortunate and unnecessary. It is a burden for any future property owner. This is not, it's not similar to a shared driveway that we see sometimes with single family homes in the neighborhood. With apartment buildings, 7 units in one, 5 units in the other, there is a lot more traffic and noise that would be going behind the house. The easement causes undue burden on the historic property. Parking issues will be exacerbated. The 1900 block of Colfax is a densely populated block, and it struggles massively with parking and traffic right now. And then although the parking requirements are technically fulfilled, and I understand the density things that the city is wanting to do, there's still a qualitative matter to consider. In practical use, not only will the design add new vehicles to the street from new residents, it will displace parking of the current tenants living in the 7 units in the apartment building, moving their cars to the street. This block has always been full of vehicles, and because of the density of the apartment buildings there. But in the last 2 years, the opening of 3 restaurants on the block, the Birch, Bradstreet, and Lowry Hill Meats, has added to the problem, and it now spills on to the other blocks as well. The Lowry Hill Neighborhood Association was not approached at all by the applicant. I cannot officially speak for the association, but I can say it is disappointing that the applicant did not make any effort to contact or converse with the neighborhood in this way.
If there I can was, ask some final thoughts, and then we need to keep the meeting.
Yes, I understand, but they got a chance to speak, so we Absolutely. Should get a chance to yep. speak. But there was also a mention of what is down the street. This is the Effie Day house. This is another house that has apartments in it. They spoke of the high rise to the south, but as you can see, that new building would be like up here and really change the streetscape. This is an example of some of the other buildings on the street. This is the one that I was speaking of that was kind of the mistake from the past. The other ones, you can see the roof lines are very different from the proposed building. They're more like the FEJ house. So in conclusion, I just would like to summarize by saying the purpose of zoning is a simple one: to separate incompatible uses. In some ways, zoning does constitute a taking since it can limit a property's economic value. But in Euclid versus Amber Realty, the US Supreme Court in 1926 upheld the concept, saying that zoning was a reasonable exercise of a city's police powers. I ask the committee agree that this is not a good fit and deny the appeal. Thank you.
Thank you. Would anyone else like to speak? Anyone else? Seeing none, I will close the public hearing. I'll see if there's any questions for staff or Councilmember Wright.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'll just note that, you know, a lot of conversation has been around compatibility with the overall neighborhood and certain contributing factors at that sort of expanded review. But my understanding, based on what I've heard from testimony and our legal advice, is that we're really anchoring it to the specific designated property and compatibility with that. And with that, I think staff's evaluation of the failing to meet that criteria is pretty clear, and I would contend it's consistent.
Thank you, Councilmember Reich. Councilmember Goodman.
Thank you, Madam Chair. This is an interesting case and one I've been involved in for a long period of time. I think both sides make a lot of really good points, and I'm going to try to thread the needle here on what I think makes the most sense based on the city's overall point of view with regard to preservation as well as building and density. So I am going to move, and then I'll explain, that we approve the certificate of appropriateness subject to the condition that the height of the new building will not exceed the peak of the roof of the day house. In addition to that, it should be consistent with the materials, color, style, and setbacks of the day house specifically. And that the review of the new proposal, if there is one, shall be sent back to the Heritage Preservation Commission for review. Unless Mr. Nilsson would like us to take that up instead of the HPC, I'll defer to Mr. Nilsson.
Madam Chair, Councilmember Goodman, with the conditions of approval being as they are, that it could substantially affect the proposal, I think the proper path would be to go back to the HPC.
Okay, then, Madam Chair, I would note that it would go back to the HPC for review, and I'd like to speak to that motion.
I apologize. This action today would go to the full council. You are approving new construction, but then a subsequent proposal would. Have to go back to the HPC. Again, the certificate of appropriateness application is subject to the 60-day law as well.
Okay, so what I'm trying to say here is I think it's legitimate that something be built, but I don't think what's proposed is legitimate. And I don't think that something that towers over the day house makes any sense. And I think the style of the house in terms of its design, materials, setbacks need to be taken into further consideration. I believe we have the right under the law to do so because the building, the designation is legally described as lots 1 and 2. And if there were no individual findings with regard to the lot, then we go back to the Secretary of Interior standards, and the Secretary of Interior is clear that the standards need to be the building needs to have features of scale, size, and proportion and massing to protect the integrity of the property designated. So I think it's really important to have this be compatible with the house next door while allowing something to be built. I realize that there is a concern about parking and there's a concern about traffic and congestion, but we've already crossed that hurdle. We made a decision as a council to say that we think building on empty lots within the realm of compatibility is legitimate, and if you're very close to a transit station, you shouldn't have a parking requirement. And I supported that, and I still do. I do think it's good that there are parking spots available for the day house. I'll note that should any development come forward, the applicant would be required to come back to us for a variance that would a lot area variance that would determine whether or not you would have to reduce the number of units in the day house from seven to five, and that in and of itself could reduce the parking by having less people living in the day house. And with a building that is smaller in size and scale and height, there might be less people living there as well, which could potentially make the situation with parking better as well. I think within this, I would move to approve the historic variance to maintain the existing setbacks from the interior property line of the day house located at 1900 Colfax as well. So essentially we're saying if you can come up with a design that meets the Secretary of Interior standards and doesn't exceed the height of the day house, it's something the Heritage Preservation Commission should consider. And should you then move forward with a building of this project and a lot split, you'd have to come back to us to get a variance to reduce, to keep the number of units in the day house at 7 rather than what the zoning allows at 5.
Okay, so Councilmember Goodman has moved to grant the appeal for the certificate of appropriateness, including several conditions, which we'll make sure that we get in writing to the clerk, that anyone write them down as Councilmember Goodman was speaking.
Madam Chair, I'm happy to work with the clerk after. I have some notes that I took during the testimony, okay. So I can provide those notes.
Excellent. And then as well as granting the appeal for the historic variance of the setback. Mr. Nielsen, I wanted to clarify, though, that one of the conditions was for further review of the revised design by the HPC, and you're saying that there is not time for that step to occur?
We could consult with staff. I think that's unlikely, Chair Bender. You know, one of the things I think that the motion makes clear that the committee, should it approve the motion, is in favor of new construction, just that it hews closer to the Secretary of the Interior's guidelines according to this designated double lot and the landmark structure. So there, I think the potential review here, because it is a review that the HBC has not had the opportunity to have of that proposal, could be perhaps in just a sort of a committee of the whole format with the HBC, not a reformal application, because the council does have to take final action on this application, which requires action by the full council and mayor's signature.
Okay. All right. And are we expecting that we would be able to have the new design by the time that the council votes, or we're just relying on our conditions to guide that final design, and we would then rely on staff to make sure that the conditions have been met?
Yes, that's correct. You know, in past precedent where conditions are imposed related to design, we do often provide the authority with staff to ensure that those conditions are being complied with. In similar fashion here, I think there's a desire to have the HBC just look at this because they have not had that opportunity. Again, that could be done in sort of an informal format through a committee of the whole type scenario.
Councilmember Goodman.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Mr. Nielsen, I want to make sure there's some level of review because we have mentioned to the applicant multiple times that making the building smaller and making it more consistent with the character of the neighborhood is something that we potentially could support once all the facts were heard, and they've refused to do it multiple times. And they didn't even go to the Neighborhood Association and ask for their opinion. So how am I to trust that anything would come back that would be acceptable?
Yep. Chair Bender, Councilmember Gooden, at some level, I would hope that the council would have faith in their professional planning staff, that there are staff that are familiar with the regulations and the Secretary of the Interior standards, and that should a new proposal be forthcoming, that you would have faith that staff could review that to ensure that it is compatible with those guidelines. That regardless, the conditions that you've suggested would have to be complied with in order to get us to get the certificate of appropriateness, to move on to the next phase of zoning review, to get the building permit. So the conditions are there. They would have to be complied with. It's just a matter of ensuring that they're complied with. I would suggest that staff has the ability to do that. If you would like additional review by the HBC, I think that I do think that makes some sense. But in terms of where we are at with the procedural posture today, I think that would have to occur in some sort of informal format, and not a whole new application process, which just effectively means we haven't taken final action today.
Given that, I guess I would suggest that then we need to make sure that the conditions are very clear, yes, and achieving what guidance we need to give to staff and the applicant.
And
Councilmember Goodman.
And in that vein, too, I have staff direction to draft findings, which would incorporate those conditions, would be good. And I would advise doing that.
So what I was going to note is that I would be moving also to ask staff to draft findings and clarifying in my motion to the clerk all of the items. I mean, like this front yard setback issue of the porch being further forward, These are all issues that should come back to us for final findings prior to the council meeting for Committee of the Whole, actually, next Wednesday. So my office will be very active in making sure the spirit of some of these design changes are written out so that staff will know exactly what we meant when reviewing any future application.
I don't want to derail this, the details of this conversation. I could just throw out another option would be to forward without recommendation for now. And okay, just want to make sure you're comfortable with the conditions as they stand. Okay, so then on Council Member Goodman's motion to grant the appeal of the certificate of appropriateness with several conditions related to fitting in with the historic designation of the entire lot, as well as granting the appeal of the setback variance. Is there any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in approval, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? That carries. I will note that that included a staff direction to prepare findings. So that moves us to item number two, which is a certificate of non-conforming use appeal. I will note that I need to leave by 11:15. So we will lose quorum at that time. So we need to finish this item by 11:15. That should be plenty of time. I don't see a lot of people signed in for this item, but I will need to make sure that everyone stays within the time that's been allotted for this item. And we'll make sure everyone has time to speak. Thanks.
All right. Good morning. So the appeal that's before you is an appeal of the Board of Adjustment decision to deny a certificate of nonconforming use to establish legal nonconforming rights for a used car dealership located at the properties of 2636 to 2638 West Broadway. The appeal applicant is Justin Ebel. He is a relative of the property owner. The original applicant, just for reference, was State Auto Corporation. They would be leasing the property. The current zoning is OR2. It's does not allow for any kind of auto sales in that zoning district. On this site, used auto sales have been established since the 1990s, and that was when the zoning did allow for car sales. Just to familiarize you with the site a little bit, so West Broadway is down here. There's an existing office building, a canopy structure, a detached garage, and some parking and sales area on the site. So under the zoning code with non-conforming uses, several conditions apply. First, legal non-conforming uses and structures are allowed to continue so long as they remain otherwise lawful. If a non-conforming use is discontinued for a continuous period of more than a year, it is deemed to be abandoned and may not thereafter be reestablished or resumed. And finally, any subsequent use of the land or structure must then conform to the requirements of the district that's located in. So both CPED staff and the Board of Adjustment found that the use had not remained lawfully established, and that was because a city license had not been obtained for a car dealership on the site within 5 years from now, or in the previous 5 years from now, and therefore those non-conforming rights had been lost. So as I mentioned, auto sales have occurred on the site since the 1990s, so I'll just go through the zoning history a bit more. It was first zoned B3S, and as I indicated, that zoning did allow for auto sales of used cars. Then in 1999, when our updated zoning code was adopted, that zoning changed to C2, and that zoning still allowed for auto sales, but it limited it to new and vintage vehicles. A rezoning study then later occurred in 2003, which again changed the zoning to C1, where no car sales are allowed. And then another rezoning study occurred in 2009, and that's where we got our current zoning of OR2, where no car sales are still allowed. So the used car sales became non-conforming as of 1999. In addition to zoning requirements, there's also licensing requirements, and those come from the city and the state. So in the city, all motor vehicle dealers are required to be licensed. That license is tied specifically to a site, and we have had no active city licenses on the site from 2011. That last license was held by the property owner. We do know that, from records that we have, that the site has been used for car dealers by car dealers since 2011, even though there hasn't been a city license in effect. Records submitted by the applicant indicate that the dealers that were using the site did have state licenses. So during this time, city enforcement records show that attempts were made to notify the users of the site that a city license was required or needed to be obtained. In 2013, licensing had sent a notice to that dealer at the time that a license was required. That dealer came into the zoning office, we know, met with zoning staff. They were told that non-conforming rights had been lost because it had been 2 years since the last city license had been obtained. And then they did identify what options they had to rebut abandonment and retain non-conforming rights, but no action had been taken at that time. So then in 2014, licensing had sent the property owner a citation because the used car use had continued to operate. Again, no action had been taken to address the non-conforming issue. And then the last record we have is from this year, where our zoning office had sent a notice of non-compliance to the owner. So to address non-conforming issues and rebut abandonment, the applicant has to bear the burden of proof to illustrate clear and convincing evidence that the use of the property for the non-conforming use that's operating was not discontinued for more than 1 year and has remained otherwise lawful since 1999. With no city license being obtained since 2011, and that there were, that the previous dealers and owners were made aware of these requirements, it was determined that auto sales have not been lawfully established since 2011. So that's the period, that's the issue, where they have to prove that they have not abandoned the use for the last 5 years. But the board concluded that the applicant failed to present clear and convincing evidence that the use of the property is illegal non-conforming use for the sale of used automobiles. So that's where it concluded. I can take any questions.
Thank you, Ms. Medmeyer. Just clarifying, OR2 allows for auto sales, but not used auto sales. Is that correct? Is that what you said?
It allows for no auto sales.
No auto sales. Okay, yes. Thank you. Any other questions for staff? Okay, there are none. So I will open the public hearing. I assume the person who signed in is from the applicant, Justin Ebel. Ebel, come on up, please. I'll ask you to keep your remarks to 10 minutes. Perfect. Should be plenty of time.
I'm here today to speak about the property at 2630 at West Broadway. I put a map up to show that to the south is a gas station. To the north is a daycare. Our property has one way in, one way out. I just wanted to add to Ms. Windmere's statement that I did not receive any of the letters. The letters were all sent to the address, so they were sent to the occupant that was renting from me. And until this last one, when we were actually there, we received the letter and did comply with that to fix it. I sent a letter to Vince Auto Group, who was the last occupant, a certified letter stating that I wanted to see his dealer's license, bond, city license, and insurance to make sure that he was compliant. And I did not receive anything from him. So then I did, I got him out of there. I did evict him. To have a dealer's license down there, there must be this paper signed by the zoning office to allow that. And in order to get a dealer's license down there, and that had to have been signed for the state to allow that license to go down there. Therefore, I was not aware that there was not obviously city licensing down there. That's about all I have today. I just asked for your help today to let us continue on with this. And one thing I'd like to add, there is a car lot down the street operating with a dealer's license that's one block down the street from it. So on the same street, obviously.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks for your time.
And you own the building, but not the business. Is that correct?
Yeah. My father owns a building. I've taken over for him because he's a vulnerable adult. So.
Thank you. Okay.
All right.
Any other questions? Thank you. Would anyone else like to speak? Come on up.
I I've been there like 25 years, and if you didn't want to give somebody else a license, I guess I'd try to go back. I don't know what else I would. That property was for my retirement.
Sir, could you give us your name, please, and then?
Oh, I'm Dale Ebel.
Okay.
Property owner.
Gotcha. Thank you.
2638 West Broadway. And when I was there, I had good. I mean, when I go down there now, they still honk the horn. Hey, my dad bought a car from you. You know. So I mean, I do like it down there, but I'm getting older and out of shape, kind of now. But I don't know. We didn't know about the license. The city not getting paid, but they were getting signed by the zoning for that. So we just figured everything was okay. Now, the guy that was in there last, you know, I don't like saying it on tape, but the truth's the truth. He wasn't too good. You know, he was a bad guy. And we found out, I even called the gal at the city and I said, hey, I got a bad guy, I think, down there. How do I get him out? They said, well, he's not a bad guy. I mean, I really did, and that's all I can say. I just wanted to at least give you my part of it. I served my time in the service, and I come back and had a restaurant in Emerson and Lowry. It started out in 1972, so I kind of stayed around the area. Nobody knows me hardly. I did help the Jordan area years ago. I was on a committee when I was a little bit quicker, and we got the policemen on bikes and stuff like that. But then I went on and, you know, raising the kids. So that's it, I guess. You got to state something. Bye.
Thank you, sir. Would anyone else like to speak? Anyone else?
They're pretty shy.
Okay, no problem. Seeing none, I will then close the public hearing. Council President.
Thank you, Madam Chair. This is a difficult one, but I think the one of the most frustrating parts about it is that, you know, we have 2 years where we had no city license, and there apparently was no or very little follow-up for that on our part. But I'm going to move to deny the application. I think this is a change. The zoning changes that were recommended by the West Broadway Alive plan are good changes, and we have to respect the work that was done around that process. This is next, as was pointed out, is next door to a gas station, but on the other side of it is the Lau Community Center, which is a really, you know, great use for that property, which used to be a funeral home when I was a kid. So, you know, I think we're seeing changes on West Broadway, and I think we have to respect the planning process that people put in place, or the work that the planning process produced. So I'm going to move to deny the appeal.
Thank you for the motion. Is there any discussion? I think I would say, I mean, staff did a very thorough job, I think, of documenting mm-hmm. the legal context with which we have to make the decision, which was that the business wasn't operating legally. I would offer to the property owners that Ms. Widmeyer could help connect you with staff in CPED that is, you know, could let you know what uses are allowed under the zoning. And there may be some resources available to you from the city to understand what are the options going forward for use of this property. And I hope that the city can provide some support for that. And it would likely not be planners within Ms. Widmeyer's section, but another section of CPED. Our long-range planners or our economic development planners, I think, could be helpful to you. So with that, is there any further discussion? Seeing none, all in approval, please say aye. 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 Any opposed? That carries. We are adjourned.
Thanks for that. That was good.